Welcome to my channel MK Mediguide Lectures, learning with artworks like drawing and calligraphy.
In this video, we will discuss about the possible pathophysiology mechanism of cytokine storm. COVID-19 is a rapidly spreading global threat that has been declared as a pandemic by the WHO. The majority of SARS-CoV-2 infected patients remain asymptomatic or develop mild symptoms. However, about 15% of patients, largely older and with comorbidities, develop severe disease with interstitial pneumonia and or acute respiratory distress syndrome, as well as multiple organ failure, which are widely believed to be as a result of uncontrolled cytokine release, leading to cytokine storm, which also known as hypercytokinemia or cytokine release syndrome, which is an aggressive or hyperactive immune response with the release of large amount of pro-inflammatory cytokines, which isn't only unique to COVID-19. It can also occur because of an infection, autoimmune condition, or other disease. It may also occur after treatment with some types of immunotherapy. Due to the SARS coronavirus 2 genome being closely related to SARS coronavirus and MERS coronavirus, and the accumulated clinical and experimental data on those coronaviruses infections, the interaction between the host immune response and the SARS-CoV-2 is mostly hypothesized by researchers. Here, first we are going to review and compare the possible pathophysiology mechanism of mild infection and severe infection in young and elderly adults with COVID-19 respectively. But first, let's have a sight on normal immunological responses in young adults with mild COVID-19 infection. Initiation of the immune response against invading coronavirus begins with a direct infection of the bronchi and bronchioles epithelium in lungs. In first, antigen and dependent innate immunity provides the first line of leukocytes defense against the microorganisms. Innate immune defense involves several cell types, including leukocytes such as neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, monocytes, macrophages, lung epithelial cells, mast cells, and natural killer cells. Following initial COVID-19 infection, lung-resident dendritic cells become activated and change to antigen-presenting cells, or APCs. Indeed, APCs are the first line of defense in recognizing various pathogens. Activated APCs ingest and process an antigen and migrate to the lymph nodes. Then, in the lymph nodes, APCs present the antigen in the form of MHC peptide complex to naive circulating T helper cells, inducing the immune response. Following activation of naive T helper cells receptor by MHC peptide complex, T helper cells become activated, proliferate and differentiate to CD4+ or T helper lymphocytes and CD8+ or cytotoxic T lymphocytes. Then, CD4+ T helper lymphocytes further differentiate into T helper type 1 lymphocytes and T helper type 2 lymphocytes with different cytokine profiles. T helper type 1 cells derive cellular immunity and release pro-inflammatory cytokines such as interferon gamma, interleukin 1 beta, interleukin 12, and TNF alpha. These cytokines exert host antiviral responses in different ways. It is reported that cytokine interferon gamma is more important because it can inhibit viral replication and enhance antigen presentation, while TNF alpha triggers the immune cell's localization at infection site and promote apoptosis. On the other side, T helper type 2 cells activate humoral immunity and antibody production and release inflammatory cytokines such as transforming growth factor beta, TGF-beta, interleukin 4, interleukin 5, interleukin 9, interleukin 10, and interleukin 13. TGF-beta induces maturation of naive helper T cells Two, the helper 17 cells, which are potential effectors against pathogens. In fact, a balance between T helper type 1 and T helper type 2 lymphocytes activity is observed in healthy adults with COVID-19 infection. Furthermore, CD8 plus T lymphocytes, as cytotoxic cells, secrete cytotoxic molecules such as granzyme B that kill infected epithelial cells. Indeed, CD8 plus T lymphocytes in natural killer cells play a critical contribution in viral clearance. Both T and B cell responses against COVID-19 absorbed in the systemic blood pool 1 week after the initiation of COVID-19 symptoms. Patients with COVID-19 identified an accumulation of mononuclear cells, likely monocytes, in T cells in the lungs, with low levels of hyperactive T cells in the peripheral blood. These findings suggest that T cells are attracted away from the systemic blood into the infected site, mean lungs, to control the COVID-19 infection. Generally, activation of different T helper cells and release of sufficient cytokines and chemokines recruit more innate, cell-mediated, and humoral immunologic responses to control COVID-19 in adults. As well, it seems that the balance between pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory immune responses in the healthy adults can shut down immune activity at the right moment. Now, let's have a view on disrupted immunologic responses in older patients with severe COVID-19 infection. In contrast to asymptomatic or mild patients, when COVID-19 pathogen enters the body of elderly and weak adults, pro-inflammatory immune responses become vigorous and uncontrollably active. Crosstalking innate and adaptive immune pathways lead lung epithelial cells, activated monocytes and macrophages, and T lymphocytes to massively release a broad array of cytokines, leading to cytokine storm. Although it is still a subject of investigation, some explanations for this phenomena have been proposed. For instance, a high rate of rapid apoptosis of viral infected epithelial cells, called pyroptosis, in the respiratory tract due to massive viral replication may cause an enormous release of cytokines and induce a cytokine storm. And impaired anti-inflammatory responses in elderly adults may correlate to increased activity of pro-inflammatory responses. Hence, some elderly adults with severe COVID-19 infection cannot shut down their pro-inflammatory immune response. Quite a lot of studies reported most patients with severe COVID-19 exhibit markedly increased serum levels of pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines, including interferon alpha, interferon gamma, interleukin 1 beta, IL-6, IL-12, IL-17, IL-18, IL-33, tumor necrosis factor alpha or TNF alpha, granulocyte colony stimulating factor or GCSF, granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor or GMCSF, interferon gamma inducible protein 10 or IP-10, C-reactive protein, monocyte chemoattractant protein 1 or MCP1, and macrophage inflammatory protein 1 alpha or MIP1 alpha, and anti-inflammatory cytokines, remarkably interleukin 10. Interleukin 6, IP10, IL-10, TNF alpha, MIP1, MCP1 alpha, and GCSF levels positively correlated with disease severity. One of the most important cytokines produced as a consequence of SARS-CoV-2 is interleukin-6, a pleiotropic pro-inflammatory mediator that plays a key role in the pathogenesis of the cytokine storm. It is produced by almost all stromal cells, immune cells like B lymphocytes, T lymphocytes, and other non-lymphocytic cells such as endothelial cells and tumor cells. The production of this cytokine is increased by interleukin 1 beta and tumor necrosis factor alpha. Different actions of interleukin 6, which are suggested to give rise to cytokine storm, include: due to the overproduction of interleukin 6 and TNF alpha, T lymphocyte dependent protective responses mediated by both CD4 plus and CD8 plus T cells may potentially fail because these cytokines can inhibit T cell proliferation and activation. In fact, low counts of CD4 plus and CD8 plus cells has been reported in peripheral blood, spleen, and lymph nodes of severely injured COVID-19 infected patients, thereby contributing to the development of lymphopenia. Moreover, synergistically, ILT6 and TGF-beta induces maturation of naive helper T cells to T helper 17 cells, which secrete mediators acting on monocytes and macrophages in alveolar epithelial cells and stimulate the synthesis of interleukin-8. Interleukin-8 is a powerful chemoattractant and activator of neutrophils, and the apoptosis of neutrophils are inhibited by this chemokine. Thus, upon release, interleukin-8 plays a key role in stimulating neutrophil survival and recruitment to the lungs. Indeed, high numbers of Th17 lymphocytes can be found in peripheral blood of patients with severe SARS-CoV-2 infection, which are likely involved in triggering the cytokine storm. Besides, IL-6 mediates monocyte differentiation to macrophages and enhances mononuclear cell infiltration to inflammation site, as major infiltrated cells responsible for alveolar damage were monocyte and macrophages, but very few lymphocytes. IL-6 also promotes the proliferation of myeloid progenitor cells and the growth and activation of leukocytes, as well as induces pyrexia and the synthesis of acute phase proteins such as C-reactive protein. In addition, IL-6 can suppress the functions of T lymphocytes such as CD8 plus cytotoxic and natural killer T cells and other cells like dendritic cells and macrophages aim to eliminate coronaviruses, thereby reducing the ability of the immune system to clear such infections. Important role of other cytokines in COVID-19 induced cytokine storm include interleukin-1 beta and TNF-alpha, which are mostly generated by activated macrophages, stimulate neutrophil functions. TNF-alpha also causes the apoptotic death of lung epithelial and endothelial cells. It has been also shown that IP-10 induction in severe SARS-CoV-2 infection exerts a strong chemotactic action on T lymphocytes, monocytes, and natural killer cells. Furthermore, IL-17 cytokine recruits monocyte and neutrophils to the site of inflammation, hence strengthening inflammation. Last but not least, GM-CSF mediates relevant intracellular communications between pathogenic T helper type 1 cells and CD14+ and CD16+ monocytes. High numbers of CD14+ and CD16+ monocytes are detectable in COVID-19 patients with severe involvement of lungs, where these cells actively participate in induction and amplification of tissue infiltration by macrophages. Many studies suggest that in critically ill COVID-19 patients, cytokine storm lead to remarkable pathological consequences. Indeed, the cytokine storm elicits immunological changes that can potentially weaken the immune response pointed to clear SARS-CoV-2 infection. It is necessary to mention that cytokine storm directly may lead to immune cell death, tissue damage, and respiratory shutdown. It was observed that ARDS, pneumonia, and multi-organ dysfunctions are the main immune clinical symptoms of COVID-19 infection. It is largely accepted that ARDS and pneumonia in deadly cases are due to cytokine storm, but it is far from clear whether cytokine storm or direct effects of the virus or the synergistic effects of both contribute to multiple organ failures in severe COVID-19 patients. It lost diagnostic features of cytokine storm. In clinical setting, there is an urgent need to detect the laboratory parameters which can be useful to diagnose cytokine storm A recent meta-analysis of 21 studies globally included 3,377 patients in 33 laboratory biomarkers suggest that when compared with the group of less severe subjects, most severe patients were characterized by high blood levels of interleukin 6, ferritin, CRP, followed by high numbers of white blood cells associated with low lymphocyte and platelet counts, in particular, significantly higher neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio, which could provide a valuable diagnostic platform for critically COVID-19 illness. And with this, thanks for watching our video and support us by subscribing our channel and do like and comment below.